¿Qué tal, amigos? ¿Cómo están? Una nueva edición aquí en Cristina Radio Network. Esto es Auto 060. Tenemos un show bastante interesante, como siempre, muchas entrevistas, muchos test drives. Seguimos viajando por el mundo. Estuvimos la semana pasada en Las Vegas, ahora en Puerto Rico probando autos de Mini. Y esta semana vamos a analizar un estudio. We're going to switch back to English because we're going to talk to John Osborne. He's the research director of J.D. Power and Associates, who has very interesting key findings about a new marketing study about how we are buying cars here in the United States. How are you, John?
I'm fine. How are you, sir?
Excellent. Thank you very much for your time and sharing this information with us, which is very, very interesting. I mean, car manufacturers put a lot of money and resources into like how they market their cars to us, and it's very interesting to see these key findings from J.D. Power and Associates. Can you talk a little bit about the general study, please?
Sure. The issue study looks at the entire shopping process for new vehicle buyers. There's actually kind of three components to it. So we survey actual new vehicle buyers and ask them about the other vehicles they actually shopped for at a dealership but decided not to buy.
Okay.
So we refer this to as rejection.
Okay.
Why asking the shopper why they decided not to buy this vehicle. And we also ask them about other vehicles in the segment which they purchased but they decided not to buy. So, example, they bought a Ford Fusion, and then we ask them, well, why didn't you consider the Honda Accord or the Toyota Camry?
Yeah.
And then we ask them the reasons they did not consider or avoided these models. And finally, we ask why they bought the vehicle they did. These are the reasons that motivated them to buy the vehicle they actually ended up buying.
Yeah, very interesting. So, I mean, like the amount of information that is now flowing through internet, because years ago, I mean, not very long time ago, we didn't have these resources, at least for the general public.
Right, right to our fingertips. Obviously, the majority of people are using the internet before they're making decisions, even before they go out and actually shop for the dealership.
Yeah, that's one. That's one of the findings in the study, right? Like a lot of people, I believe 81% said that they look in the internet, which can be very useful, but also can be a pretty. I'm not going to say confusing, but there's way too much information sometimes. I think I read in one study recently that people visit up to 18 pages sometimes while they're shopping for a car. It's a lot of information to digest.
Oh, I'm sure. But it saves time in the long run and pretty much ensures you're going to buy the vehicle that you really want. It'll meet your needs to the highest degree.
Yeah.
So it's a good thing.
Yeah, no,
good,
absolutely. And I think it's, eventually, I think when the market is more mature and technology and people adapt it more, probably it's going to affect the way dealers do their business, right? Because people are going to be able to configure the car and pretty much order it if they are patient enough. I mean, here in the States.
We'd like to see the industry do that eventually.
Yeah. So, John, can you please tell us what are the other findings in the study? I think domestic manufacturers are doing pretty good in some aspects, right?
Yeah, well, one of the interesting things we found this year is we added a new question, a new purchase reason, and we asked about technology. And we did find that domestic buyers were more likely to buy their vehicle due to advanced technology more so than the import buyers. And, of course, there's a lot of distinctions between technology. Technology isn't really limited to just what's in front of you or what's in the console. We often think of technology as being Bluetooth technology and pairing up the smartphone, audio. But there's a lot of other technology features that we haven't really delved into. There's gas-saving technology, driving technology.
Oh, okay.
And there's actually a lot of technology under the hood. So when people, we think of it as Bluetooth. In fact, virtually all vehicles, about 90% of the vehicles are now sold with Bluetooth technology and smartphone pairing, et cetera. So it actually extends beyond just that.
Yeah,
but I do think the domestics are chasing technology,
yeah,
more so than other brands. Every brand has to, you have to stand for something in the marketplace. Porsche and BMW more or less own performance, and Honda and Toyota stand for reliability. So you have to stand for something, and I think domestics are doing a good job of positioning themselves and contenting their vehicles with a lot of technology. Went over consumers.
Yeah, is this also a reaction because, for example, to the Koreans, because Hyundai and Kia have been doing, I think, a pretty good job about packaging the cars. I think, for example, some of the cars like the Acera is like $35,000 with everything. I mean, there are no options. It has everything that you can think
right,
of.
Right, right, right.
Like keyless entry, Bluetooth, as you mentioned, navigation, all those things. So in that sense, I think that's the way the market is going, and that's probably what the domestic manufacturers are reacting to.
I think so. I mean, now that quality is really a non-issue, there's really no bad vehicles on the marketplace. So
yeah.
That's not a reason to avoid a vehicle.
Yeah.
So now it's about the comfort and the technology and the features. So that's where you win over customers. And of course the looks, styling is a
yeah, absolutely. I think that's still a pretty big reason, right? I mean, as we were saying, like manufacturers spend a lot of money in their marketing campaigns and ads, but it, at the end, it's like if you like it and you can afford it, and if on top of that it has like all the toys, even better. But like, I guess people are still, as you said, like Porsche. If you're gonna buy a Porsche, you're gonna buy a Porsche anyhow.
Right, right, right.
So other things. What is there any particular technology, as you mentioned, like that people are leaning into more in the domestic vehicles?
We didn't really get into exactly what they meant by technology. And we don't know if there's any trending responses to this. This is the first time we've ever asked this question. So next year, we'll be able to tell a lot more about what that means to them, technology, and what it is doing to the market, if it's really actually winning over buyers to domestics or not. You mentioned an important thing that's actually validated by data. The number one and two reasons why you avoid certain models, the number one reason is exterior look or design. Obviously, if you don't like the look of a vehicle, you're not going to consider it.
Yeah.
But the second reason to avoid a vehicle is it costs too much money. So those are the big fundamental, you know, price and look. Those
yeah.
are the big differentiators in the marketplace.
Okay.
When it comes to shopping.
Absolutely. And gas price and gas mileage is still one. I'm still very, very high in the list, right? I mean, even though, as you mentioned, technology is getting into that. I mean, we have the Mazda high-tech thing, Volvo just introduced like they're going to just build four-cylinder engines with turbochargers and superchargers and all that. So, but fuel economy is still very high in the list, right?
Oh, yes. It's really king. Ever since the gas prices surpassed $3 a gallon back in about 2011, it's the number one purchase reason for non-premium models. That's the most influential reason why I bought my car is gas mileage. For premium brands, it's more about performance and quality of workmanship and image, not so much about price,
yeah.
gas mileage.
And is there any findings in terms of selecting regular gas cars versus diesels or even like hybrids or electrics? Is there a breakdown on that in that aspect?
We do have that. And, of course, people buy hybrids and electric vehicles for the environmental reasons and to save gas. But we really haven't seen that market take off. You know, back to the old adage where you couldn't pay me enough to do something. Well, we can't pay them enough to buy these vehicles. Well, the government will subsidize your purchase by $7,500. And still, this market really hasn't taken off. It's a very, very small percent of the overall market, maybe 3%.
Yeah.
But the technology is there, and you have to be there because it will be the future. So even though manufacturers might be losing money right now making some electric vehicles or hybrids, you got to invest in that technology now because if you don't, you may find yourself out in the cold in 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, and that, like the new regulations for the CAFE standard, the average mileage for manufacturers is pushing technology a lot in that sense too, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
They have to do it.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting to see because, I mean, if you talk to some engineers, and I don't know if they've been completely honest, some of them don't really know because it's a lot. I think it's, 55 by 2025? So, I mean, it's a very high target.
Yes, it is a little bit odd that the government can impose this type of mandate on the consumers because that forces us to buy cars. We're all looking for smaller cars, certainly compared to 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And we're all concerned about gas mileage. Now, is that really, we can only buy what they make, and the manufacturers are tending to make smaller cars. So, you know, it's kind of a dilemma there.
Yeah. But I think they're coming up with great ideas. For example, they just at the Detroit Auto Show, they showed the new F-150 with aluminum structure, which is, they say, it's gonna save about 20% of in gas mileage. And in that segment, it's really, really important.
Oh, sure. Ford's with the EcoBoost, and Ram is touting themselves as having the best mileage. So gas mileage is important to everybody, even full-size truck buyers. So
yeah. So we're talking with John Osborne, Research Director of J.D. Power & Associates. And, John, you said that this Avoider study was done, 29,000 owners of new car purchases?
That's right.
Wow, that's a really big study, huh?
They bought in April and May of 2013.
Yeah. Can you please, the findings of the study are available for everybody. You can go on a webpage so they can look for what's going on there?
Yes, jdpower.com. You can look at the press release, and we also have a lot of other vehicle information on that side as well.
Yeah. So you mentioned at the beginning of the conversation that you asked what car they didn't select. Is there, and you said in general, more domestic than imports, but is there a brand or one manufacturer that stands out? We only have 1 minute, sorry, but go ahead.
No, actually, people tend to avoid domestics. People that buy imports and avoid domestics, they still have concerns about reliability and poor quality and depreciation, even though those largely have been alleviated through quality improvements for the domestics. So it's really a non-issue, but in some people's mind, it's still out there.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, John Osborne from J.D. Power & Associates. Very interesting information about this, the study, what the way we're buying cars here in the United States.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Bueno, esa fue la información, la entrevista con John Osborne de J.D. Power & Associates para analizar las razones por las cuales los consumidores aquí en Estados Unidos están comprando vehículos nuevos y por qué están prefiriendo últimamente vehículos de fabricación nacional o de marcas nacionales en contra de los importados. Así que, muy interesante. Vamos a poner la información en Facebook, facebook.com/auto060. Y no se vayan, que esto es Auto 060. Yo soy Javier Mota. Ya regresamos con más información de la industria de los autos.